This video is brought to you by Captivating History. Attila the Hun is synonymous with conquest, vast empires, ruthlessness, and power. Very few in history survived to be remembered, let alone take on a life of their own in the minds and imaginations of future generations for years to come. Attila was a great military leader, horseman, soldier, and expansionist, but he was also incredibly brilliant and politically savvy. He would conquer lands as far away as Italy, Spain, Greece, and Hungary within his lifetime. Starting from Central Asia and working his way west, Attila's legacy lives on. Attila was brought up with his older brother, Bleda. They were raised to become dual Hunnic kings. Both brothers were trained in combat on horses, caring for horses, sword fighting, archery, and the lasso. In the Hun culture, horses are one of the greatest treasures you can possess, and are symbols of wealth and might. They were the primary mode of travel and fighting. The Huns fought nearly every battle on horseback. Attila and Bleda were also raised on stories and sagas of their ancestors' outstanding achievements, and partook in various invasions and skirmishes into Roman territory. We don't know much more about Attila's upbringing. What we do know is gleaned from Latin and Greek texts. The Huns had oral histories, and these are lost. We do have strong evidence suggesting Attila partook in Roman raids. The raids and war councils on the Romans helped Attila get familiar with Roman tactics and familiarize themselves with the Romans, which would help him in his future conquests. At the time of Attila and Bleda's ascension to Hunnic leadership, tumultuous negotiations continue with the Byzantine Empire. Attila and Bleda met with Byzantine emissaries sent from Emperor Theodosius II in 439 CE at Margum, about 40 miles from today's Belgrade. This meeting would cement the tone for Byzantine and Hunnic negotiations. Attila and Bleda refused to dismount from their horses, insistent on conducting this the Hunnic way, on horseback. The emissaries complied, which sent a strong message that Hunnic customs would take precedence over Roman ones in Attila's presence. This initial meeting eventually led to the Treaty of Margus, which was signed in 435 CE. The Treaty of Margus would lead to the Byzantine Romans agreeing to exclusive trade negotiations with the Huns, and none with the Huns' enemies. Attila and Bleda also demanded the return of all the refugees who had fled to the Roman side. Two of those refugees were of their blood kin. They had the two boys executed. Their deaths would help solidify Attila and Bleda's rights to the Hunnic throne. Another aspect of this treaty would also increase the tributes the Romans would give to the Huns. Attila and Bleda's uncle, Rigila, the leader of the Huns before them, had collected annual tributes from the Romans in return for leaving them in peace. After Attila's meeting, the tributes more than doubled to 700 pounds of gold a year. In exchange, the Huns would not attack, raid, or disturb the Romans. The treaty enabled them to withdraw their troops from that region and send their forces on to Sicily, Carthage, and northern Africa. The Romans' hold there was growing more tenuous from the Vandals. Emperor Theodosius felt the price was well worth it to keep the Huns as allies. Initially, the Huns left Byzantine in peace. However, a few years later, the Vandals had soon captured Carthage. The loss of Carthage led to the Roman armies leaving Constantinople with very little protection. Attila and Bleda took this opportunity to attack. They captured the vital port of Constantia and attacked along the Danube River. When questioned, they reported that the Byzantines had violated the Treaty of Margus. They also claimed that they had not returned all refugees to them, that the bishop had desecrated the Hunnic graves of their ancestors and robbed the graves of their treasures. The Huns wanted the bishop turned over to them. Emperor Theodosius sent out a general to investigate, but did not hand over the bishop. Theodosius didn't think the Huns would actually invade. He believed that the treaty that they had brokered was sound and ignored the advice of his council members, who wanted him to tread carefully when dealing with Attila. For the next 2 years, Attila and Bleda would lay waste to the Byzantine Empire, raiding, pillaging, and doing as much damage as possible. They had picked up some of the Roman tactics of fighting, including siege warfare. This would prove very effective. They literally wiped whole cities off the face of the map and went tearing through prosperous Roman cities, getting within 20 miles of Constantinople. Theodosius finally recalled his army from northern Africa, and Attila and Bleda, rich from the Byzantine Empire's profits, returned to the Hungarian plains. In the next 2 years, Bleda was killed. Whether it was from his own brother or a war raid is unknown. Regardless, Attila would go from co-regent to full leader of the entire Hun Empire. After Bleda's death, we can fully see just how much of the Huns' victory is attributed to Attila himself, as opposed to both brothers' efforts. Once the East was as plundered as much as possible, Attila turned to the West, setting his sights on Gaul. He made his way there, intending to take Toulouse. During this time, the Western Roman Empire, Valentinian III's sister, Honoria, was sequestered in Ravenna. She was not happy with her brother and sent Attila her ring with a plea for help against her brother via her servant and friend, the eunuch Hyacinthus. Attila's solution was to marry her himself and, as a dowry, accept half of the Western Roman Empire, crowning himself emperor. He sent Hyacinthus back to Ravenna, where Valentinian discovered the plot and had Hyacinthus tortured to learn all of the plot's details. Valentinian told Attila there was a mistake and the marriage could not take place. Attila disagreed. Intending to take his bride and his portion of the Western Roman Empire, he later marched on to Ravenna. When Attila first traveled to Gaul, his soldiers took as much as they could. A key difference between the Hunnic army and the Roman army was that the Roman soldiers were paid a fixed wage, while the Hunnic army's wage was based on how much they could steal. The Romans were so concerned about Attila that they did something totally unprecedented. They allied themselves with the Visigoth king Theodoric. The Huns, however, allied themselves with the Ostrogoths from the east. They ultimately faced off in a bloody battle on the Catalonian plains. Here, the Visigoth king Theodoric died. The next day, the Romans and Visigoths left the plains. Attila and his army lay in hiding, wondering if this was a trick to get them out into the open. We may never know the true outcome of the battle, but history has repeatedly stated that the outcome is unclear. While Attila was in Gaul, the new Byzantine emperor, Marcian, cut off the gold payments to the Huns. After the legendary raid on Byzantine led by Attila and Bleda, the gold payments had been reinstated, but at triple their previous payments. Attila, returning from Gaul and the Catalonian plains, was furious. He humiliated the ambassador sent from Byzantine by stripping him, stealing his gifts, terrifying him, sending him back, and demanding the reinstatement of gold. Both Roman emperors, Valentinian and Marcian, thought Attila was weak after the undecided battle on the Catalonian plains. Attila would retaliate by attacking Italy, with an actual target of Ravenna, and the goal of collecting his bride Honoria. This was a wholly unexpected attack, and Valentinian was stunned. He couldn't call upon his former allies, the Visigoths, and invite them into the heart of this territory. But the Huns were a terrifying group, and they made their mark known. They lay such a successful siege on the wealthy port of Aquileia, annihilating that city by setting it on fire, killing all of its inhabitants, and plundering everything of value, that archaeologists today have no clue where the original city's site lies. Some say the lucky survivors went on to found Venice. Lagoons and watery areas were safe from Hun invasions since they refused to fight without their horses. After plundering Aquileia, the Huns pillaged Pavia and Milan. Valentinian would flee to Rome from Ravenna. Eventually, Pope Leo I spoke to Attila in Mantua, convincing him to leave Italy and return to his lands in Hungary. Why Attila left without his bride is unclear. Perhaps it was because the Huns were loaded with carts of stolen treasure. Maybe the food supply was running out. There was a drought in Italy at the time. It could have been a combination of these factors. Also, Attila had learned that Emperor Marcian was attacking his land while he was busy raiding Italy. When Attila returned to the Hungarian plain, he took a new, young, and beautiful Hun bride named Ildiko. On their wedding night, he ate and drank more excessively than usual. During the night, he suffered a brain aneurysm and died in his sleep. Others speculate that his new bride had killed him. The Hunnic Empire was split between three of his sons, and soon after, the empire fell into chaos and disintegrated. It was clear that it was Attila himself who had kept the empire together through sheer force of will, personality, and the mystique that surrounded him, terrifying his enemies and allies. Attila's legacy has made itself known through the centuries and will continue to echo through time. His name inspires fear and awe, and his raids through Europe can still be physically felt and seen. He unquestionably altered the course of history, and he will be remembered as one of the greatest military geniuses of all time. To learn more about Attila, check out our book, Attila the Hun, A Captivating Guide to the Ruler of the Huns and His Invasions of the Roman Empire. It's available as an ebook, paperback, and audiobook. Also, grab your free Mythology Bundle ebook while it's still available. All links are in the description. If you enjoyed the video, please hit the like button and subscribe for more videos like this.